you know, cough is a common symptom with which the children present to pediatricians in office practice. And it is known that about 30% of children will have cough, or, 30% of children will have cough at any point of time. Therefore, it's a very, very common symptom. And we will see how to approach cough in this module. And first of all, we'll see, this is a brief outline of my presentation. First of all, we'll see the basics of cough and how we classify cough. And then we move on to evaluation of cough in outpatient setting, office practice. Then the most important point is we have to identify the underlying cause. Therefore, we have to identify pointers that will indicate an underlying cause. We'll see that. And finally, we'll also look when to refer this patient. Most of the cough can be managed at office practice, but there are some conditions where we need to make an early and appropriate referral. And we'll see when to refer. And finally, we'll summarize. Cough, we all know, even my teacher used to tell when parents are very anxious about cough, cough is a good thing. It's not a bad thing. Cough is a protective reflex. It helps us to clear our airway secretions as well as prevent second aspiration. Therefore, it's good to have cough. We usually tell that to patients who are very anxious, it's good to have a cough because it helps us, helps the disease process to clear. Therefore, it's good to have cough. And sometimes what happens is when parents are very anxious about cough, we actually tend to overdo things, give lots of medications to suppress the cough. If you spend lots of time talking to them and tell them this is a normal physiological process, which is trying to help us, then probably they will understand better. And cough, when the cough reflex is stimulated, I'm not going to the physiology of cough, when the cough reflex is stimulated, three things happen. We take a deep inspiration and fill our lungs. And then there is a compressive phase. Compressive phase is your glottis is closed and your muscles of expression work so that high intrathoracic pressure is generated, goes up to 100 millimeters of mercury. And suddenly the glottis opens. This results in gush of air with a sound that helps to clear the secretions and debris. Therefore, cough has got three phases. And as I said, cough is a very troublesome children for children. And it disturbs their sleep, their activity, and play. Therefore, cough, when it is excessive, it will be very distressing. And it is distressing for the parents as well. Because if it is chronic, they think something very serious is happening for my child. They fear something sinister. Another thing is they'll have sleepless nights. They have to go to work. They have to do their daily activities because of cough. The entire family will be affected. Therefore, our responsibility is not only to treat the cough, and it's important to allay the anxiety of the family as well. Cough is classified based on the duration of cough. An acute cough is anything that lasts less than 2 weeks. And we have the chronic cough, which lasts more than 4 weeks. And anything in between is subacute. Anything between 2 to 4 weeks is subacute. There are different classifications. This is the simplest one I came across. And as I said, we have to identify the underlying cause. Based on that, if we find an etiology, we call it specific cough. If you're not able to identify the etiology after extensive evaluation, we call it non-specific cough. And finally, by the nature of cough, is it a dry cough or wet cough? Wet cough is something some comes from the chest. We say chesty cough. And dry, we usually refer to upper airway issues and allergic problems. Therefore, this is another classification. And when we come to the evaluation of cough, it's important to take a detailed history and do a thorough physical examination. By the end of it, we'll know where is the lesion and what is the lesion. History should concentrate on onset. Onset means when it started, how it started. Is it a sudden onset or a slow onset? As well as the duration. I said for classification itself, the duration is very important. And then we have to ask whether it's a dry cough or a wet cough. And we have to ask the quality of cough. Whether it's a barking quality, it means something coming from the larynx, a woofing, you have the diagnosis, or a VC cough, you have the diagnosis. And we should also know the aggravating and relieving factors. response to medication. This is particularly very important. If you are treating asthmatic, okay, this is very, very important, response to medications. And the pattern, this is very, very important. The pattern, we look at the different patterns of cough. There are three patterns, you know, of cough. And here you can see the duration in the x-axis and the intensity of cough in the y-axis. The first pattern, what we see here is the episodic cough. Episodic cough means the cough intensity is very severe to begin with and gradually wanes off. And by the end of 1 week, everything settles down. And this tend to recur over a period of time. This is called acute episodic cough. This kind of cough is very common in toddlers with viral infections. And this kind of cough is also common in asthmatics because they present with the symptoms, you treat it, it subsides. You don't put on control and medications, it comes back again and again. Therefore, it's important to ask the temporal pattern. Episodic cough could be a viral infection or a atopy like asthma, asthmatic cough. The second pattern is an acute cough. The intensity wanes off over a period of time, but it takes about 4 weeks to settle. This again happens with 10% of acute viral respiratory infection. It doesn't settle down within a week. It takes a longer period to settle down. This is again benign. This is most likely to be a viral URI with delayed recovery. The third type of cough indicates a serious disease. This is called persistent unremitting cough. You see with time, the intensity of cough increases. This indicates underlying serious problem. Therefore, whenever you evaluate a cough, the acute things you have to look at, you have to look at the temporal pattern of the cough and classify it. This will be really helpful in the office practice. Next, when you go to the examination, we usually do the routine examination, which includes a general examination, examination of the respiratory system. And we should always look at the ENT, look for things like post-nasal drip, is there a nasal lesion, all those things, and markers of atopy, we all do that. And the impact of the illness on the growth and development of the child, that's also very important, and the impact on the family as well. These are things we have to look at. But one most important thing, what I would like to point here is, and this I learned only of late. Sometimes we go by what parents says, like a wet cough or a dry cough, you know, whatever they say, we think might be the correct thing. Studies have shown, you know, like wheeze, the wet cough or a dry cough, the kind of symptoms they describe might not actually, you know, the real thing. Therefore, whenever they come to the clinic, you have to witness a bout of cough, an episode of cough. If they don't cough, you have to ask them to cough and find out what kind of cough the patient is having. And nowadays, lots of parents are very intelligent. They bring a recording, video recording of the cough. That helps a lot. And at the end of your examination and you know, history and physical examination, you should be able to answer couple of things, important things. Where is the problem and what is the problem? Where is the problem? Not only the cough helps identifying the site of the problem and the additional noises, the respiratory noises also help locate the problem. This is something very useful. If the patient has got snuffles, probably the problem is in the nasal passages, usually URI, allergic rhinitis. Patient has got snoring, something related to the pharynx, nasopharynx or oropharynx, adenoids, or sinusitis with post-nasal drip, all those things. If the patient has got stridor and barking cough, you know where the pathology is, usually laryngeal. Patient has got wheeze, again, you know it's intrathoracic airways. The patient has got grunt, is you know it's involving the alveoli and lung parenchyma. Therefore, along with the, you know, character of cough, the additional respiratory noises also help you to anatomically localize the pathology. And what is the problem here? During the course of history and physical examination, you will come across some pointers that will help you to identify the problem or the specific diagnosis. We'll see some common conditions. The most common cause, majority of cough in children, is due to viral upper respiratory infection, where you have a child having, you know, low grade short duration fever, coryza, and a cough, usually a dry cough. And physical examination will be completely normal. And in this situation, you have evaluated the child, you've got the history, examination is completely normal, then probably no need for, you know, investigations and treatment, you know, most of the time, lots of education and simple medications will help. And we have already gone through the natural process. And as I said, 10% of children, cough can last up to a month. The important thing is we should not miss out. When you do a fast examination, it's important to count the respiratory rate. If you don't do that, you might miss a pneumonia. Therefore, it's important to listen to the chest and you know, check the respiratory rate. And if the patient has got tachypnea and lung signs, it could be a pneumonia, bronchiolitis, or a wheeze-associated LRA. And if the upper respiratory tract infection is associated with a barking cough, it could be a evolving croup. Therefore, these are things you have to identify, and these are the pointers for the diagnosis. And since, you know, this is very common, we have to elaborate more on the treatment aspects of viral URI. And we all know that cough syrups and OTC medications can have significant side effects and are not safe in children less than 2 years. This is FDA. And American Academy of Pediatrics, you know, restricts the use of cough mixtures for children less than 6 years of age. This is not because they are not working. It's not working as well. These medications are not working, and these medications can have serious side effects. Between, like, I think 2005 and 2008, they have identified like 27 deaths in US due to cough medications. These medications can cause CNS depression and can cause arrhythmias and sudden death because they might have antihistaminics, opioid medications. Therefore, it's not only like they are not effective, they are also can cause, they can also cause severe adverse effects. And there is a tendency for us to write prescription for, you know, acetylene syrup or salbutamol syrup. And we have to know that bronchodilators are not effective in non-asthmatic cough. They're effective in asthmatic cough, but they're not effective in non-asthmatic cough. And antibiotics, you know, like I think Dr. Palaniraman has insisted, and we have learned lots of things from him about rational use of antibiotics. It's not going to be effective, and it's inappropriate to write antibiotics for viral URIs, but we have to make sure it's really viral URI. You have to follow it up, you know, regularly so that it resolves. Sometimes what starts as a viral URI, you know, can have secondary bacterial infection, then develop a problem. Therefore, it's important to follow these children until everything resolves. And there are studies in from 2007, showing that honey, buckwheat honey and honey may be helpful to reduce cough. And studies have shown it, honey improved nighttime cough and improved, sleep of parents as well as children. Therefore, this is something you can try. One to two teaspoons of honey at bedtime for 3 days have been used in lots of studies, and they have showed improvement with that. And beware, honey is safe, but there are some side effects as well. You know, honey could not be used in children less than 1 year of age because of risk of botulism. And if you use honey frequently, there is also a risk of dental caries. These are something you have to keep in mind. And I think the most important part, you know, of treating a, you know, cough due to viral respiratory infection is education, education, education. Therefore, we have to spend time to tell them this is a benign condition, self-limiting condition. And we have to explain whatever the diagram I have shown, the natural course of the disease. And we have to make sure to use this in a consultation for talking about avoidance of smoke exposure. If somebody is smoking at home, cough is going to be severe. There is a risk of asthma. Therefore, we have to use that. And we have to identify if there are any irritants, you know, like if they are using incense or something like that, we have to change that practice. And we have to identify we have to tell them warning signs of worsening as well. And we all know that, you know, cough hygiene is very, very important. And now we are teaching our our patients about cough hygiene because of COVID. Lots of parents have learned this, but we should make a routine, about respiratory hygiene and cough hygiene, how to cover their face and nose when they sneeze and cough. And second group of the vast majority, I said, is viral respiratory infection. And second group is atopic child. Atopic child, it could be a preschool wheezer or a bronchial asthma, child with bronchial asthma. Here, the diagnosis is a three-step process. Usually, they will have recurrent episodes. Second, they will have airway obstruction. Airway obstruction is nothing but wheeze. You have to demonstrate wheeze. And third thing is they should have some bronchodilator response. Therefore, you treat them, they have to respond. If they don't respond, it could be something else. Therefore, you have to rule out alternate diagnosis. Therefore, three-step process, recurrent episodes, and there should be wheeze, and there should be bronchodilator response. Isolated cough as a presentation of asthma is very, very rare. Therefore, you have to be very careful, when the patient has got isolated cough to make a diagnosis of asthma. The wheeze, again, is not going to be present all the time. Therefore, it's important, whenever a child has wheeze, it's important to document the wheeze. Therefore, lots of importance is given to physician-diagnosed wheeze. Therefore, if you have documented, if they go to somebody else, they will also have a look and see, and this patient had wheeze before, and they have given bronchodilators, the patient has responded. Therefore, it's easy for the other person also to make the diagnosis. Therefore, whenever you have, we listen to wheeze, don't give just prescription, just write in the notes, patient had wheeze and responded to bronchodilators. That's very, very important. Do we need to do investigations for atopy? Definitely. We have to do an investigation. That's a chest X-ray. This is something we need to do because we might miss out. This is a child with foreign body and treated as wheeze. The child has got collapse. Therefore, rule out alternate diagnosis, we definitely need to do a chest X-ray, or sometimes it's better to have a baseline X-ray as well so that we don't miss out on things. Spirometry is not absolutely essential because not every clinic will be having a spirometry. The facilities are limited. Therefore, whenever you have access to spirometry, even children more than 6 years of age, try to do a spirometry and, objectively document what I have said, like airway obstruction and reversibility. That can be done clinically as well. But if you have facility for this, you can do it. Therefore, it's not necessary to refer all asthmatics for spirometry. If you have facility, do it. Treatment, I'm not going into treatment of asthma. Treatment, we all know, is inhaler medications, both controllers and relievers we have to give. And lots of atopic children, about 60 to 80% of asthmatic children can also have allergic rhinitis. And allergic rhinitis can happen, alone as well. Therefore, in children with allergic rhinitis, they can have cough as well because of post-nasal drip. And in that situation, antihistaminics are helpful. I prefer giving non-sedating antihistaminics. And in severe cases, we might need to use nasal steroids. And I think the major chunk of cough, is usually due to a viral URI and asthma or atopy. And the rest, I think we need to identify because we should not miss out on these problems because early diagnosis is going to help. We'll see first important infections which can cause cough. And in our country, it's very, very important. We should not forget tuberculosis. And clinical phenotype is unexplained fever that is not explained by any other reason. It lasts for more than 2 weeks. And as I said, in the patterns of cough, the third type of cough, persistent unremitting cough. The cough is not getting better. So, it's increasing over a period of time. If it lasts for more than 2 weeks, or the patient has a weight loss, documented weight loss in the last 3 months, or you have started treatment and you have started nutritional intervention. If the patient is not gaining weight, you have to think about tuberculosis. Therefore, these three things you should not forget for presumptive diagnosis of tuberculosis. Unexplained fever of more than 2 weeks, unremitting cough more than 2 weeks, weight loss or patient not gaining weight. And the X-ray, definitely we need to do an X-ray. X-ray. Miliary lesion, and older kids can have cavitated disease. These three things are suggestive of tuberculosis, and it's important, you know, not to jump into treatment. Okay, after looking at the X-ray, it's very, very important to try and get a bacteriological diagnosis before starting on treatment. With this MTB gene expert, we are now able to diagnose TB better, and we can also, you know, have an idea about drug resistance, because it, you know, it shows rifampicin resistance as well. And treatment is ATT. Therefore, it's very important to try to get a bacteriological diagnosis. And bacteriological diagnosis in children, we know that it's very difficult to get sputum samples in younger kids. And therefore, we have to go by our gastric aspirate or induced sputum. The second infection is still there. You know, we can see this is not gone, it's still there. I will just show audio clipping. I think this is the classical pertussis. Like we do see still patients, one or two patients in a month. Pertussis typically presents like paroxysms of cough, bouts of cough, and followed by inspiratory woof. And then child can have a post-tussive emesis and become very tired. This is very classical, very easy to make a diagnosis. And therefore, if a bout happens at your clinic, it's great. Otherwise, parents will definitely bring a video of the cough. It's a very easy diagnosis to make. But we should also know that, you know, there are atypical presentations of pertussis, especially as young infants, less than 6 months or less than 3 months, they can present just like with apnea, cyanosis, gagging, all those things. Therefore, you know, young infants having apneas or cyanosis or gagging-like episodes with cough, probably, again, we have to check for pertussis. And in fully vaccinated and older kids, they can just present like any other cough. It could be, you know, it could be just a non-specific cough. Therefore, there are studies which showed that patients having non-specific cough, the serology was positive in 25 to 30% of patients for pertussis. Therefore, pertussis is still there. There we have to, in any child with chronic non-specific cough, we should consider pertussis. And if you have a classical, you know, paroxysm with the inspiratory woof, it's easy to make a diagnosis. And nowadays we have, it's available everywhere. You have to do a nasal swab and send it for PCR to get the diagnosis, like very fast. And the diagnosis, and the, you know, pickup rate is quite high earlier in the disease. First 2 weeks, you see, you know, the pickup rate is quite high. Later on, you know, you might not get it. And other thing, Dr. Palani Brahman will tell, these patients can have relative lymphocytosis. Leukocytosis with relative lymphocytosis is not present in all the patients, but this is something you can look for. Treatment is macrolides, azithromycin, 10 milligram per kg for 5 days. And you have to consider admission in younger kids. As I said, they can go for apnea, cyanosis. Therefore, younger kids, you have to advise admission. And if they have complications, apnea, cyanosis, pneumonia, encephalopathy, advise admission. And we should not forget foreign body as well, because, you know, during COVID times, lots of kids, you know, all the kids, younger kids and older kids, are at home, it's difficult to supervise. We had a spurt of foreign bodies recently. And this is a typical history. I got it from a mother, and this is a very short clipping. And There are 3 points, you know, this mummy makes actually. The deer, this is sudden onset, the deer. And தொண்டை அடைச்ச மாதிரி இருந்தது. There's a choking, choking sensation or choking episode. அதுக்கப்புறம் ரொம்ப கஷ்டப்பட்டு இருமுனாங்க. இந்த மூணு பாயிண்ட் ரொம்ப ரொம்ப இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். ஓகே, தெர்ஃபோர் சடன் ஆன்செட், சோக்கிங் அண்ட் காஃபிங். அண்ட் திஸ் மம்மி டிட் விட்னஸ். மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் த டைம்ஸ் இஃப் பேரண்ட்ஸ் ஆர் சீயிங் பேபிஸ் டூயிங் சம்திங், தே வில் ஆக்சுவலி அவாய்ட் த சோக்கிங் எபிசோட். அண்ட் தீஸ் சோக்கிங் எபிசோட்ஸ் மைட் நாட் பி விட்னஸ் இன் மோர் தென் 50% ஆஃப் த டைம்ஸ். தெர்ஃபோர் மம்மி, யூனோ, இஃப் யூ ஷீ டெல்ஸ் த சைல்ட் புட் த நட் ஆன் த, யூனோ, ஸோ நட் அண்ட் ஸ்வாலோட் தென் சோக், it's easy to make a diagnosis. But most of the times, in the sense, almost 50% of the times, these episodes are not witnessed. Therefore, you have to go by this mother. If she says sudden onset, and even, you know, the choking she might not have witnessed, and some parents might not have witnessed. If they say sudden onset of cough with the respiratory distress, you have to give weight. You have to suspect foreign body.
Only Anthony, your audio of the cough is not audible.
Okay. Therefore, history of choking is very important. Sometimes the choking episode might not be there. Sudden onset of cough, you have to take it seriously. And second thing is you go by your respiratory examination. This also depends on where the foreign body is lodged. If the foreign body is lodged in the peripheral airway, mainstem bronchi, will have reduced air entry or a differential air entry. Comparing both sides, you will identify that the air entry will be reduced on the side where the foreign body is lodged. If the foreign body is lodged in the central airway, you know, there won't be reduced air entry. There won't be differential air entry. Therefore, that again is not absolute sign. Okay. And in those situations, you hear a monophonic wheeze. Monophonic wheeze is wheeze, which is of same quality, heard different intensity. Therefore, same sound will be heard in different places. In asthma, you'll hear the quality of wheeze sound will be different in different places because there will be variable airway obstruction in different places. And other thing, apart from monophonic wheeze, some children, if the foreign body can be lodged upper airway, in the larynx, they can have stridor. Therefore, reduced air entry won't be present in all the cases. In central foreign body, you can hear a monophonic wheeze or stridor. And the third thing is X-rays. X-rays, again, the location of foreign body decides, as well as the degree of obstruction. If it is a partial obstruction with valval mechanism, you get an obstructive emphysema. In this patient, you see obstructive emphysema on the left side. Again, the heart is shifted to the right side. And if it is a complete obstruction, you will have a collapse. You will have collapse. And if it is central foreign body, this is a X-ray taken recently. Last week, we have seen one patient. The central foreign body, X-ray will be normal. Therefore, you know, history, respiratory examination, and X-rays can be variable in different patients. The important thing is high index of suspicion, sudden onset of cough, and respiratory distress in a toddler, you should have foreign body in your differential diagnosis. And you all know that, bronchoscopy is both diagnostic and therapeutic. I'll show a short video clipping of a foreign body being extracted. So groundnut being extracted with a basket device from the right main bronchus. Therefore, early referral for bronchoscopy really helps when the, you know, foreign body stays for a long time, the risk of complications is high. And if you can remove the foreign body within 24-48 hours, the rate of complications is much less. And apart from foreign body, in case of cough, you have to think about neighbors. As I said, we have the gastrointestinal tract. Therefore, things can come from the gastrointestinal tract as well. Therefore, aspiration syndromes can be from above or due to anatomical defects or from below. And the neuromuscular patients, if they are coughing, you have to think about aspiration. because there is swallow coordination won't be good. Therefore, neuromuscular patients who have poor swallow, they can aspirate. And anatomical defects like brachiocephageal fistulas, and they can aspirate, and they will have usually feed-related symptoms. And GERD also, there is a risk of aspiration. And we should not forget, still there are some grandmothers giving oil to babies, castor oil to babies, small babies. They can come with cough and aspiration syndrome. And for swallowing dysfunction anatomical defects, we do video fluoroscopy. Therefore, these patients might require referral for video fluoroscopic swallow study. And for GERD, if facilities are available in your nearby tertiary center, can do PA study or manometry. PA study with manometry. This is one of our patients, infant, who presented with recurrent episodes of cough bouts associated with feeding. And we did video fluoroscopy. You can see the contrast in the tracheobronchial tree. You can see the contrast in the tracheobronchial tree. And this is bronchoscopy of the patient. Just above the carina, you can see the fistula, the tracheal part. And another neighbor is heart. You know, very rarely, it's not very common, very rarely cardiac diseases, you know, can cause cough, especially if the child has got pulmonary edema, can present with cough. Some vascular rings, because of compression, they can present with cough. And the other thing is, children can aspirate their own secretions from the upper respiratory tract, post-nasal drip. And USES, we previously called post-nasal drip syndrome, now we call upper airway cough syndrome. It's not very common, but it's important for all children with cough to do a thorough ENT examination. And if you're not sure, probably you have to have an ENT consult. And others, this type of patients come once in a while. They come with a big file, and the parents will be very anxious, but the child won't be very anxious. And this is the cough you get.
Audio is not there, Anthony.
Audio is not coming?
Yeah.
It's not coming, audio?
Audio not coming.
Okay, sir. This is...
All the cough, it is not coming.
Okay, okay. Let's see. Check. Not coming, sir?
It's not coming.
Okay, sir. This is kind of cough where, you know, like repetitive barking cough, especially in a child, you know, who is more than 6 years of age, and adolescents, they come with the repetitive barking cough. They cough lots of times in your clinic. Parents will be very anxious. They'll be having a file with lots of investigation, including the CT scan, come to you. They have been to lots of doctors for, you know, a few weeks, and the cough is not settling down. The only thing, you know, that makes the cough settle is sleep. While the child sleeps, there is no cough. And your examination will be completely normal. And this is usually a diagnosis of exclusion. And this is previously called habit tick cough. Now they call it somatic cough syndrome. And as I said, this is a repetitive barking cough, subsides once sleep. And there is lack of distress towards the cough by the patient. It's called labial indifference. And usually, like if you do some basic investigation like the X-ray and do a thorough clinical examination and try to reassure the parents as well as and do counseling with the child, the cough usually settles. In case if you feel the child might have a comorbid anxiety or depression, child will require referral to a psychiatrist. And this is a summary of the approach to cough. And anything I just said, this is more of chronic cough. Any cough lasts for more than 4 weeks, you know, we call it a chronic cough. As I said, we have to identify the thoroughly check and identify the underlying diagnosis. Underlying diagnosis, if you are able to make the underlying diagnosis, it's called specific cough. And even though if you make the diagnosis, there are some conditions to require a referral for further evaluation and treatment. Therefore, these patients you have to refer. Or if you treat the cough and if the cough is not improving, definitely you have to refer. And if the cough lasts for more than 4 weeks, and if you don't know the diagnosis, if you, by clinical examination and basic tests, if you don't have the diagnosis, called non-specific cough. Non-specific cough, you classify them into dry cough and wet cough. And dry cough, I think you can be reassured. You can reassure the parents if the examination, everything is normal. You can wait. It could be a, you know, acute viral cough with delayed recovery. You can wait for a couple of weeks. If it settles down, it's fine. If it doesn't settle, if it is dry cough, you can give a trial of, you know, asthma treatment, inhaled corticosteroids for probably 1 month to 3 months. And if it settles down, then you wait. If the child develops another episode or if the child develops wheeze, then treat her asthma. If it doesn't settle down, this child also will require evaluation. If it is a wet cough, it's a different ball game. I think if it is a wet cough lasting for more than 4 weeks, you might be knowing a condition called protracted bacterial bronchitis. I will come to that later. In that case, if you make a clinical diagnosis, you can give a trial of oral antibiotics, usually comoxiclav for 2 to 4 weeks. If it resolves, it's well and good. If it doesn't resolve, it could be suppurative lung disease. You might need to do further evaluation, including a CT scan. Those patients will require referral. And a little more on protracted bacterial bronchitis. Protracted bacterial bronchitis is common in younger children, less than 6 years of age, and usually presents with wet cough. Wet cough, and chest, there won't be any wheeze or any other, you know, chest signs. They will have just wet cough. And you know, on examination, there should not be any indication of any other specific disease or a specific cause. Therefore, just wet cough. Examination has to be normal. And then you can give a trial of antibiotics. And the cough usually settles within 2 to 4 weeks. And it's a retrospective diagnosis. Therefore, you can, if the patient has got 4 weeks of wet cough, clinical examination normal, you can write probable PBB. Only if it resolves, you can come in the diagnosis complete. Therefore, it's a more of a retrospective diagnosis. And I have told there should not be features of or pointers for specific disease. The specific diseases are the diseases that cause suppurative lung disease. The important ones are mucociliary disorders, immunodeficiency, aspiration syndromes, and congenital anomalies. And I think we have talked about other conditions. Brief word about cystic fibrosis. This can present, you know, as wet cough in the first year of life. You have to remember these patients, you know, are there, and it's not very common that they are there. And if you diagnose them early, you can make lots of difference to their lives and the parents. I've got families with two patients with cystic fibrosis. They're finding it very difficult to cope with the condition. Therefore, if you make a diagnosis, you can give genetic counseling. One child with cystic fibrosis, easy to manage. If they have two children, it's very, very difficult. And future seems to be a little bit brighter now because lots of drugs, specific drugs are coming for cystic fibrosis. Therefore, don't just leave, it's a genetic condition. I need not diagnose this condition. Therefore, I think it's important to diagnose rare diseases as well. And the clinical pointers here will be persistent wet cough of early onset, oily stools, and failure to thrive. We have the triad of symptoms. Wet cough, oily stools, and failure to thrive. Think about cystic fibrosis. And this is summertime. Therefore, sick infants who present with dehydration, you have to, if you do the electrolytes, you normally expect any child with dehydration, metabolic acidosis, bicarbonate would be low. If you see a child, you're an infant, who is sick and dehydrated and have metabolic alkalosis, and if you ask child is having cough for a long time, then it could be cystic fibrosis. And we do see one or two, you know, infants during summer like this with cystic fibrosis. This can be easily missed and they can die actually. Therefore, this again, And the older kid with a wet cough, clubbing, cystic fibrosis is one of the commonest cause of bronchiectasis. Therefore, we have to think about cystic fibrosis. And we have facilities for sweat chloride and genetics now. Treatment is going to be multidisciplinary. Therefore, you are going to refer these patients. Another condition which can usually easily diagnose the child presenting with wet cough from the neonatal period or early, less than 6 months, they start with wet cough. Neonatologist actually can pick up 80% of these cases because neonatal presentation is present in 80% of these children with primary ciliary dyskinesia. What kind of neonatal presentation they have? They present with neonatal term babies with respiratory distress. Normally, TTNs present with respiratory distress, but they settle within 48 hours. Here, the respiratory distress is slightly different. The onset will be after 6 hours. Distress won't be there at birth. Respiratory distress develops after 6 hours, and lasts more than 48 hours. They will require oxygen. They might have upper lobe collapses on X-ray. Therefore, if you find a child looking like TTN, but not behaving like TTN, and X-ray showing upper lobe collapse, it could be cystic fibrosis. This presentation is like 70 to 80% of patients with, you know, PCD. Second thing is when you have situs inversus, you know, you do an echo, if there is no heart disease, don't leave it just like that. They need to follow up this patient. They can also have PCD. What happens with these PCD children is like, you know, we ignore the clinical presentation and leave it, and they become like typical cartilaginous syndrome. And they go to the adult pulmonologist with burnt out disease, with bronchiectasis, they die early. If you can identify, actually you can change the natural course of the disease. Therefore, any child with persistent wet cough, nasal discharge, neonatal onset symptoms, it could be primary ciliary dyskinesia. Now we have diagnostic tests for it, and we can start treatment early. We can, if identify early, we can start treatment. That's going to change the natural course of the disease. And other important point I want to make is wet cough, chronic wet cough. You take X-ray, it looks normal, don't leave it just like that. The cough is more than 8 weeks, chronic wet cough, I think you might miss a bronchiectasis, just go by X-ray. And you have to have a low threshold for doing a HRCT, because HRCT will pick up bronchiectasis, very sensitive investigations for bronchiectasis. Chronic wet cough, no? More than 8 weeks, I think HRCT is indicated. Chest X-rays can miss bronchiectasis. And what are situations? You know, we have talked about, we have to consider referral. In a nutshell, specific cough, you know, and you have diagnosed specific cough for evaluation and treatment, just like foreign body, where, you know, you can't keep the patient and give bronchodilators and wait for a week and see whether it improves or not. You think about foreign body, if you have a suspicion about foreign body, you have to make an early referral. Second thing is chronic cough, you know, cough more than 4 weeks. And if you don't find an etiology for that, definitely these patients will require evaluation. Therefore, these patients have to be referred. Third thing, if you find red flag signs on your physical examination history, cough from neonatal period, feed related symptoms, chronic wet cough, failure to thrive, clubbing, differential air entry, persistent hypoxemia, not responding to treatment. All those situations, you have to refer the children for further evaluation. In summary, vast majority, you know, even though we have talked about lots of condition, about 80 to 90% of cough is due to viral upper respiratory infection. And I think education is an important intervention, and you can give a little bit of honey as well, and better to avoid cough medications. And not only they are not effective, they can be harmful to children as well. And it's our role not treat cough as a symptom. We have to identify the underlying cause by looking at pointers. If you have any pointers that will lead to the diagnosis, you have to follow that. And toddlers, very high index of suspicion for foreign body. I've already told, you know, witnessed choking history might not be there. Sudden onset of cough, respiratory distress. Air entry might be normal if the child has got monophonic wheeze that is not responding to treatment or stridor. Have to think about foreign body. X-ray can be normal in foreign body. You know, it's not necessary for a child to have abnormal X-ray all the time. Therefore, you should have high index of suspicion for foreign body. And the chronic wet cough, think of suppurative lung disease. If it is more than 4 weeks, examination is normal, child is otherwise doing well, you can give a trial of oral antibiotics for 2 to 4 weeks in your office practice. If it is not responding, then probably have to refer to a tertiary center. And early referral if underlying disease serious, a cough is persistent. We already discussed this. Thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Anthony, for your elaborative presentation for cough. I think you have covered all the topics like cough basics and classification and evaluation for history base as well as examination. And you have covered specific conditions like scenario like viral URI and pneumonia, bronchiectasis, and barking cough like types. And the atopic child like preschool visa and bronchial asthma and allergic rhinitis also. And infections, I think, covered tuberculosis, pertussis, and as well as atypical organism. And the important thing is you have covered that foreign body and as well as aspiration syndromes. And so another thing is somatic cough syndrome also, the tics also you covered. And finally, you have approached algorithmic approach to chronic cough. And what are the conditions you have to consider chronic wet cough, like a protracted bacterial bronchitis, some things we have to consider for persistent cough, you have to cover antibiotic. And cystic fibrosis, yes, even though rare, we have to consider. And another one is primary ciliary dyskinesia, and another one is bronchiectasis. And finally, so when to consider referral, what are the red flag signs? I think you have covered extensively. And I think now we are having questions, chat box. And how good is gas?
Hello?
Yeah, Dr. Ismail, na solunga. Yeah.
One second. Thank you, Anthony. I would like to have a comment from the convener, Dr. Ashwath. You would like to comment on this lecture, Ashwath? Hello?
Yeah, I'm here. Thanks, Dr. Anthony. I think you've fulfilled a long need.
Not audible, Ashwath.
The chronic cough syrups, we have all in our own practice made these mistakes of writing meaningless formulas and multiple combinations of varying compounds. I am very happy that you've given the message loud and clear that the education, parent education, is the best in drugs, and we ourselves have to be aware of how much harm we can do both for these children by giving them unnecessary medications. Thanks a lot. I think you manage the time and the slides and the messages beautifully. Thanks again.
Thank you, sir. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Anthony, for doing a wonderful job. Now you can take up the questions. Raj, over to you.
So how would this gastric aspirate but tuberculosis gene expert sensitivity and is one sample adequate, Dr. Viswanathan, EB member from Chennai?
Sir, I think the gene expert, you know, sensitivity is around 30 to 40%. It's not 100%. Therefore, if one sample is negative, but you have a high index of suspicion, you have to go for a second sample. And, you know, again, if the second sample, if it is negative, I think if you strongly feel tuberculosis, I think you have to get a second opinion from like a pediatric respiratory person or a tertiary center. And if they have facility for BAL, they can do it. Or, you know, you can start ATT.
Okay. And another one is, since honey cannot be used in this age group, that means less than 1 year or 6 months, can you please suggest alternatives? Because we have personally never seen a child with botulism with or without honey. Yeah, it's Dr. Ashwath, MCH.
I think education is the important thing. But if you have any other like indicators, like allergic rhinitis or some other thing, you can give indications. I think you can give a supportive care, like you know, if the child has got paracetamol, sorry, child has got fever, give paracetamol, some hydration, all those stuff you can do. I am not aware of any alternative. Sekha, to Hani.
Sir, can I just suggest, sir?
Yeah, please, can sir.
Probably the most sold preparation next to paracetamol in India is cough suppressant. You should all accept non-sedating cough suppressant and all. We cannot deny that, and everyone used to write in our day-to-day practice. It's a, however much you educate, it's a loud, clear message to all the pediatricians and all. Definitely, we are going to write from tomorrow. So, just like you have to educate the public.
Can you stop sharing? Anthony, stop sharing the screen.
No.
Okay, sir.
We cannot educate the public amidst our busy schedule. All the pediatricians are more quantity-minded than quality-minded. Then, in that scenario, just tell me in one word, sir, honey, I think if you give, as you said, honey is an adulterated honey, that's what we get. There is a little chance for botulism. I have seen a little older child with botulism, whom we ventilated. But just give us one word that this can be suggested to the parents. As a cough suppressant, because the parents want the symptoms to be suppressed more than anything. You cannot be educating them.
Okay. I think I will ask Dr. Palaniraman, who is known to practice very ethically. What kind of...
He is also asking the same question. That's why I asked. He has also put the question in the chat box.
Can I say, with the permission from the convener,
yes.
As per the IMNCI, less than 6 months, absolutely no cough syrup is indicated. But yes, these two children with, the, as you said, the upper respiratory, the leaky nose, the postnasal drip, they do well with the steam inhalation. As a part of steam inhalation, I do well holding the infant in the mother's, shoulder. And I asked someone to... Take the flask and open the lid, filled with hot water. This steam, would really the coughs are very well, relieved with the steam inhalation.
Let me have one query, Dr. Anthony and others and convener. Dr. Rajendran,
yeah.
Hello?
Please,
yeah. Sir, Dr. Anthony, it was a very good lucid presentation. Happy you have mentioned about the neonatal cough. Neonatal cough is pathological unless proved otherwise. As you mentioned, it's a severe disease, can be easily picked up, and cystic fibrosis can be easily picked up in the neonatal period. And my one suggestion, like antibiotic, we are fighting, and no antibiotic in my prescription, like that, there is a Telangana, there is a module is going on. Like that module, we can no cough syrup. In our prescription, it is against the commercial thing. It is totally against, as you, Dr. Raju sir mentioned, without cough syrup, our prescription or our parents won't agree that we are a doctor.
Yeah, they won't go out.
Sir, the thing is,
Yeah,
the thing is, I have seen personally, a child recently, who presented with a SVT in a life-threatening condition, turned out to be some ephedrine in the cough syrup. Therefore, there are situations I have, personally heard of, babies dying. Actually, I have got personal experience dying because of giving antihistaminics, and sudden cardiac death could be narrative. Therefore, it's not, important. It's also important to think about the safety of the children. We have to give something, but it doesn't mean you have to harm the children. Therefore, lots of deaths have been reported. Therefore, we have to be more scientific and if it is absolutely necessary, we can give specific medication. If you have allergic rhinitis, we can give probably antihistaminic. And if the patient, if you think is a, atypical pneumonia or a chlamydial infection in less than 6 months, you can give azithromycin. It's not a must to give cough medication, which might harm. And I have personally seen as well as... even SVT in infants. Therefore, you might have more experience. Therefore, cough medicine is not as safe.
Let us avoid cough syrup, sir. As you mentioned, some of the participants, they ask about the mucolytes and Montelukast. So this is what my suggestion. At least this bar for Ismail sir has come out with this cough module. Let us not prescribe cough syrup for another at least 1 week. Let us see. All our pediatrician no cough syrup.
But,
in our
One thing I wanted to share is the idea was this. I do agree with Dr. Raju sir. As in the peripheral practice, I think people never agree. Whatever you try to sensitize them or you counsel them, whatever they say, they want an instant remedy and they want a medication from you. Tough to counsel them, but I think the message should be very clear to the practicing pediatricians that try to avoid the cough syrups and try to give something else. Thank you.
Dr. Amdekar used to tell, before prescribing antibiotics, you have to think about the reason why you are prescribing the antibiotic. If there is no reason, you should not prescribe. Just like that, if you are prescribing something, it should not do harm.
You should also tell, think that patient is your child. Will you prescribe?
Yes.
That question may have to be in the backup for my...
Yeah.
Sir, one more question to Dr. Anthony.
Anthony, this is the idea behind this program because I want this thing to happen. Really, we need to sensitize the pediatricians. Sensitizing the pediatricians about the
effects. I think of the we will win them. at least if they think before writing a prescription, whether it's absolute or necessary. If they go to that level, it's a success.
One final question to Anthony. Put it in a nutshell for the participant. Correct timing of X-ray, spirometer, and allergic test. When you should do? Just as a crisp message, you please tell us.
Yes, sir. If you are going to treat as asthma, I'll definitely do an X-ray before starting treatment. Okay.
Okay.
The spirometry is not absolutely necessary. If you have it, do it. Otherwise, it's not absolutely necessary. You can start treatment because if you wait for spirometry, eventually the treatment might not get to the child. Third, allergy test is not absolutely necessary for all patients. It's only for selected patients. Therefore, you need not worry about allergic test.
Thank you.
We'll go for the chat box.
Raj, go ahead, Raj.
We'll go for discussion. Okay. What are the specific pointers for ILD, that interstitial lung disease in children with regard to cough?
ILD, when you think of ILD, when a child has tachypnea, hypoxia, the child has got hypoxia with cough. And sometimes you can hear wheeze if it is bronchiolitis obliterans. Sometimes you can hear a very coarse crackles. Therefore, ILD, tachypnea, if there is cough with tachypnea and disproportionate hypoxemia, you have to think of ILD.
From Dr. Silpa, a role of antihistaminic like fexofenadine in children with cough.
And antihistaminic have a role. If you can prove child has got allergic rhinitis, you have to know to differentiate viral URA from allergic rhinitis. Sometimes, most of the times, allergic rhinitis underdiagnosed. Most of them are treated like viral URA. Therefore, there are four cardinal symptoms of allergic rhinitis. One is nasal discharge, sneezing, nasal stuffiness, and nasal itching. And if out of the four, the patient has got two, you can make a diagnosis of allergic rhinitis. Then you have to classify intermittent, persistent, mild to moderate or severe. If it is mild and intermittent, you can give antihistaminics. Antihistaminics will relieve the cough. Therefore, mild form of allergic rhinitis, intermittent form of allergic rhinitis, you can give antihistaminics. Non-sedating antihistaminics works really well. Therefore, in those children, you can give fexofenadine or loratadine, all those things.
Another question from Dr. Sivagurunathan. How to diagnose cough variant asthma?
As I said, you have to be extremely careful in making a diagnosis of cough variant asthma. Therefore, cough as isolated symptom of asthma is very, very rare. As I said, if it is a dry cough, non-specific cough, and if it lasts for a longer period of time, then probably you have to think about a trial of treatment. If the patient responds to your treatment, then probably you can stop the treatment and wait if the symptom recurs. Definitely a child will develop wheeze, sometime later. And the other thing I want to mention here is, even though if it is a cough variant asthma, sometimes you don't hear wheeze, go through the records previously. Child might have had wheeze. Therefore, it's important to document the child had wheeze before. And when they present to you, it might be only the cough. Child might have had wheeze before, or later on they might have wheeze. You have to follow these children very closely. Another thing, in these situations, apart from X-ray, I said, rule out other conditions, spirometry will help. There are children who don't have wheeze. If you do a spirometry, they can have airway obstruction, and you can also demonstrate reversibility. Therefore, spirometry might help in these kind of patients.
Another is role of dextromethorphan in dry cough, Dr. Silpa.
That's why dextromethorphan is not a very safe medicine. Therefore, it's better to avoid in children less than 2 years of age. It's actually banned by FDA in children less than 2 years of age. And
role of mucolytic, Dr. Ganesh.
Mucolytic, as far as I know, they're not very harmful. Okay, and probably you can give symptomatic treatment with mucolytics, where they're not very harmful, but I'm not sure whether they're effective as well.
Dr. Viswanathan, and what's your take on traditional medicines apart from honey?
I think Dr. Ashwath will be the best person to tell, actually.
Yeah, yes, I think he's traveling.
Okay. I have no personal experience about other medicine, but but the only thing is that you should not allow patients to use oil or something which is very harmful to the lungs.
வீட்டுல எனக்கு டர்மரிக்கும் பாலும் போட்டு கொடுத்துருக்காங்க அது சரியா
குறைச்சிருச்சு.
Again, like asthma, isolated cough is not a manifestation of GERD. They should have associated symptoms. Therefore, there is no role for empirical therapy when children have isolated cough. You should not treat for GERD. If they have associated symptoms like vomiting, regurgitation, or hard burns, then you can treat empirically. But isolated cough as a presentation of GERD is very, very rare. They have some other symptom as well. But I think... we don't evaluate regularly our patients for reflex. It's very, very unlikely to present isolated.
And can mucolytics be given to infant with wet cough?
I think it's more important to know what is the reason for wet cough and treat the wet cough. Wet cough, if it is protracted, we give antibiotics. We think it's a bacterial infection that is occurring in the airways. If it is a protracted wet cough, have to think about a PBB and treat with antibiotics, or look for other markers. What is the reason for cough and treat it?
Question from Dr. Somsagar. What is punishment cough, Dr. Andrew?
I think he knows about this cough. I have not heard about this cough. Sir, can you please elaborate on this punishment cough?
Dr. Somsagar, sir.
Antony, it was really nice to hear you. It was like a mesmerizing. Your talk is going on. Love to hear you. I think once I referred a child, you see, going on coughing. Okay. I ruled out every sort of
Dr.
a thing.
Some said, sir, you are not audible, sir.
No. It was neither asthmatic and nor pulses. Then I referred to, I looked at the throat. He hit the surgeon. He examined the child and he put this diagnosis of punishment cough and sent the patient back to me. I was wondering, what is this punishment cough? Then I called up and he said, sir, this is like something like a somatization. To punish the parent, the child continues to cough. As if that is what I learned from the pediatric surgeon, sir.
The correct name is somatic cough syndrome, sir. Previously, it also called habit.
Somatic.
Cough.
Can I just one comment, please? Can I one comment with a cough prescription? I think the important thing about cough prescription is, I know that we keep talking about that. I think what the important message should go to the peripheral pediatricians or anyone is, I think we should know the constituent of the cough suppressant, any of the coughs. First of all, we should know that. What exactly it contains. Sometimes what's happening nowadays, I see some people also giving us drops. These are the higher concentration solutions. which has been used intermittently as a for a syrup also. See, the our pharmacists never check it honestly. Whatever ingredient they keep giving it, that's our problem in our country actually. Whereas in a country like West, the clinical pharmacists have a role in looking at what the doctor has prescribed, and they will come to the doctor if the medicine is not prescribed the correct way. But that is not happening in our country. That's a main problem. And importantly, we practitioners have to tell very clearly to the parents, the medicine is given for only 1 or 2 days. You cannot keep giving it. You cannot use the same cough suppressant next time when the child is becoming ill for something else. This is only for this time, 1 day, 2 day. You have to exactly get this medicine, not any other medicines. And you have to use this dose only, no any other dose. Just because you have the cough suppressant at home, you cannot keep giving it any number of time. That is the message. That's if you say that you will be able to satisfy your parents on 1 day, 2 day, you are given some prescription. But most important is Anthony told, we should try and not to give cough suppressants as much as possible.
Yeah, that's an important point, Dr. Vishwanathan. Because like what happens is they ask, sometimes they come for other symptom and they ask, give one cold medicine and cough.
Yes, yes.
And this happens.
Dr. Vishwanathan, you have to
be very careful and fall into the trap. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, one comment on this. Actually, as learned persons, I think both IMA and IAP should come forward to ban the OTP sales, actually. Over the counter, I think most of the parents, they buy everything and they come to buy third day or fifth day, they have 3 bottles in their hand already.
We should avoid drops. Drops has to be completely banned. So higher concentration.
Yes, Raj, take over, please.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another one is role of mucolytic agent like Ambroxol is a nebulization in wet cough, Dr. Amal Raj.
Nebulization, sir. We don't nebulize Ambroxol. I think,
Dr. Amal Raj, anything you want to enter?
Ambroxol is not, doesn't have any major side effects as such. Proven to be
good evening, Anthony. Cough.
Yeah, good evening, Amal.
Wonderful talk, Anthony. Really proud to be your batchmate. It was so nice and very crisp presentation, Anthony. Yes. And actually, there we have a few mucolytic agents like Ambroxol in the form of for nebulization, Anthony. Because as we rightly elaborated, most of the cough syrup constituents, you highlighted the side effects which may happen. So whether the mucolytic agents could be a safer option in these children, sometimes the parents will be nagging us regarding the cough. And as you rightly narrated, the quality of cough is very disturbing the child. Whether in those situations we can use these agents as just a support to therapy.
Yeah, I understand. I think Ambroxol, all these drugs are not dangerous. It doesn't have major adverse effects. And if at all, if you use also, like, it's not going to be harmful. That thing, we are sure. Yes. It's not like antihistaminic or dexamethasone. It's relatively
safe. And in recent studies, they even proved that Ambroxol has a good anti-inflammatory action also. There are a few papers which have come out about...
one thing...
What is your take on that, Anthony?
I have experienced this, like medications containing Ambroxol are a bit bitter and children tend to vomit. That's the only one thing that practically I have come across.
Okay, thank you, Anthony. And our final question from the chat box on the minimum age for starting Montelukast.
Montelukast is not for like viral cough. We use it for asthmatic cough. Minimum age is 6 months. After 6 months, we can use it. While using Montelukast, I think previously we thought it's a very, very safe drug, but we have to tell the parents to report if there are any behavioral changes and sleep disturbances. And if they experience these, we have to stop the medication.
Dr. Amal Raj, N-acetylcysteine has to be used in PICU for as a mucolytic. It is a recommended one. The aerosol nebulized form is available. Used mucolytic.
Yeah.
Thanks, sir.
I think...
அடிச்சாலும் Okay.
Yes, sir. Message has to be like
clear. Think
before prescribing. And medication has to be safe. We should not do harm. Yes.
Tobramycin nebulization should be practiced now for cystic fibrosis and chronic cough.
No? We do use tobramycin nebulization. It's a drug of choice for eradication of Pseudomonas. But first,
it's a rational recommendation, isn't it?
Standard recommendation. Standard recommendation.
Any comments from anybody? Dr.
Congratulations, Anthony. So a very simplified way of approaching cough, you have made it. Number two, as such, to be practical, it is with a cold and cough medicine is a very big lobby in the country. It's very, very difficult to get eradicated. That is the number one leading thing in with respect to economy. So only thing, we have to educate our colleagues. And one thing is, practically, it is not possible as such not to write any cough syrups as such in the practice. That is, I don't think it is practically possible, number one. If at all, the only advice we can give to the practicing pediatricians is, know what you are writing, number one. Number two, if at all, any SOS dose in the night can be used. So that can be relaxation. For example, less than 1 year, or when you are coming with the upper respiratory running nose and anything, we can use system. For example, in Jipmer, they used to regularly give, and we used to follow here also, simple promethazin in the night as an anticholinergic and as well as a sedative effect. For the baby will be sleeping so comfortably, the mother will be sleeping comfortably. And that is not the round-the-clock medication. Just a SOS in the night, when the child is troubling much, you can ask them to use. So like the dextromethorphan, after two years in the proper dose of 1 mg/kg per day, we can use. That is, even a study has come in American Academy of Pediatrics about dextromethorphan, what is the dose, and the codeine has no role. So we can use, and that too only at nocturnal night dose. So we should know when to use and how to use and proper medicines. So this is my take on this.
Thank you, Barniraman. Thank you.
Thirumurugan, any question, Thirumurugan? I think you asked. Thirumurugan?
Ask Dr. Janani Shankar also to have a comment.
Yeah, Dr. Janani Shankar.
Yes, I listened to the entire talk and it was really good. I was just recalling that we had a 2-year-old that came in with SVT, and when we probed, we found that the child, the mother, had used a lot of beta agonists from different prescriptions and medications that she had. So that message, I think, Dr. Anthony conveyed, and I think honey, warm water and honey is what I prescribe, and I think that's safe and harmless.
Thank you, madam. This is what my experience as well. When I used to be in UK, I have never seen cough medications in the pharmacy. They never used to give any cough medications. I thought it's not possible in India as well. And when I look at my teacher, mentor, Dr. Ramaswamy's prescription, I had lots of education and very little medicines. And that's what we have learned in Coimbatore from Dr. M. Ramaswamy as well. It's possible here as well to be very rational and ethical.
Your message is very clear, Anthony. Your message is very clear. Thank you.
MR will start with area 60 medicines. End up 6 medicines. Yeah.
Raj, before going, Sandhil, you want to say something? Yeah. Sandhil?
Yeah, it is. We are the ones who are prescribing. We have to think twice before prescribing cough syrups. That is the message.
Thank you. We have to be very clear. Thank you.
Thanks.
Raj, before going to the vote of thanks.
Yeah.
Raj?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, before going to the vote of thanks, I just thank Anthony for doing a wonderful job and giving a clear-cut message. Idu vandu ipo just Drishyam got released, and Anthony has done the Mohanlal's role in a very good way. I think the Kamala Hassans are waiting. One Kamala Hassan in Tirunelveli to do the Papanasam 2. And one in Tirchi to do the Papadasam too, and one in Chennai. Hope that Drishyam comes well. They have to do the programs within this month. Hope everybody, we will all attend that programs also. Please pass on the link to us, and we will enjoy and we will reach the pediatricians. Thank you.
That's a chinna vayasu kaaranga chollunga sir. Shivaji Ganesan.
Thank you,
sir.
Sir, Anthony, these are all your own slides or...
Sir, I can share the slides with you.
Yeah, you can share. Now, the one thing I wanted, the timing of the cough is also very important.
Yeah.
Most of the times we diagnose by the bedside only by the timing of the cough. night cough or evening cough, it's an allergic cough.
Yeah.
And early morning cough is a productive cough. That's teachers told. And that's a very important thing also.
So you can add on to in your talk also, sir.
Oh, sure, sir.
Okay,
sure.
Thank you. You can share your slides,
Dr. Anthony.
Yeah, I'll do that, sir, first.
Thank you, sir. Before going to order, thanks. I want to happily announce that we're IAP TNSC. We had upgraded our Zoom link. Already we are having 100 only. Now we can up to 500 members. They can see in the Zoom itself. And we have that committee itself we have started. And I really thank to Dr. Thirumurugan who had started initiation. And I think we are happy to announce that. And on behalf of IAP TNSC, I thank Dr. Anthony and his excellent presentation. I thank State Office Bearers, Dr. Dynamic President, Dr. Ismail Sir, and President 2020, Dr. Sendil Sir, and Dr. Ramesh Babu, and President 2021, and Editor, and as well as AAA, and all Central EB members also participated in this program, like Jalil Sir and Palani Raman Sir, and Janani Madam, and Swamasagar Sir. And I think Dr. South Zone VP, I could not attend this meeting, and he has conveyed me. And all the state office bearers and district office bearers, we have attended this meeting. And finally, I want to thank Dr. my colleague and friend, Dr. Aswath, who has started this wonderful module program, and thank Dr. Aswath also. And I thank one and all for this opportunity to go on this IAP TNSC. Thank you.